Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you for this really nice introduction. I'm very happy to be here. Thanks for the invitation. And thanks to the audience that you are willing to sacrifice your lunch break for drones and the sensorium of the drones. I'm really happy to be here. And this is a lecture about the sensorial experience of drones and how contemporary art is experimenting with sensorial experience of drones and how art can critically reflect about the drone's power to construct communities. And so, in other words, this is a lecture that discusses drone technology from a humanities point of view. And most central will be the aspect of aesthetic representations of drone technology in visual arts, in literature, in film, and also the aspect of a critique of technology through the lens of the aesthetic discourse. I will touch upon the relationship between technology, remote surveillance technology, and the human subject. I will also reflect about the political function of art and sort of also the political sort of the aspect of communities constructed by the aesthetic discourse. As you just already heard with the introduction, I'm actually a little bit more at home in the 19th century. I'm a scholar of German studies, but I always had an interest in technologies of seeing. So in the 19th century, I worked on the panorama and on photography and asked, like, how are these media mediating or representing the past and history? And that interest also sort of came, like Lars also said, to the 21st century, where I'm interested about remote surveillance technologies or automated surveillance technologies and their aesthetic representation. A network, it's a DFF supported network about drones and aesthetics. We are roughly 30 associates, mostly from the humanities, nationally and internationally. And we investigate drones from a humanities point of view. We talk about privacy, aspects of privacy, the public image of drones, emotions associated with drones, how do drones sense, how do they produce images, what's the relationship between the subject and the human. Also, we talk about algorithm and autonomy, and again about aesthetic representations of drones. So we are a very diverse group from media studies, cultural studies, and literature, but we have this focus on remote surveillance technology. And we had a nice conference here in June about drone imaginaries and society. So if you'd like to be associated to this network, please contact me later. I'm happy to put you on the mailing list. In any case, before I go a bit more into my lecture, perhaps I should say more what do I think is a drone. I know I see some drone specialists here already from technical engineering, but maybe not everybody is so versed in drones. And how do I define it? Well, a drone is an unmanned flying aircraft without a human pilot on board. But I'd of course have to say right away that there are also drones that can swim, that they can go underwater, that they can crawl. They are not necessarily always aerial vehicles. Often drones are categorized in two types of drones, the civilian drones, which are called the drones for humanitarian aid, for example, rescue missions. Often they are called the good drones. And then there are the military drones. There are unmanned combat aerial vehicles that usually carry weapons, missiles, and used in drone strikes. And since the Obama administration, these drones are often considered as the ultimate weapon of precision to wage riskless war and to also kind of wage a surgical and a precision type of war. In any case, in my work, drones do, and in my lecture, drones do not just represent another new form of technology, another new form of machinery. Rather, they embody a technology that, together with its human agents, can create cultural imaginaries. That means drones, together with their operators, can generate modes of perceiving the world. They can construct communities. They produce images of enemies and friends. The technology is told in narratives. In other words, they are loaded with discourse and biopolitical agendas. And I will sort of dwell on this conception of technology a little bit further in the course of my lecture, and I hope then that becomes also a bit more clear what I mean with that. But maybe speaking about drones, certainly in Denmark, but also in other places of the world, drones are quite popular. Civilian and military drones certainly attract a lot of attention in the media. In fact, Karen Kaplan, a scholar in American studies, has coined the term the drone-o-rama, which is kind of signifies the spectacle. The media spectacle about drones. And also in research, drones are a highly trendy subject. Besides the engineers and the social scientists, also the humanities have discovered the drone, sort of from cultural studies, literature, and media studies. And I think one can talk a bit about a first wave drone research in the humanities. And this first kind of wave of research was very much interested in the so-called scopic regime of the drone. They were very much focused on the geopolitical and biopolitical ramifications of drone technology. In this context, the term scopic regime was vital. This term, scopic regime, refers to the drone's visual framing. That is, for example, the way how a drone sort of sees its target, its optical perspective on the target, and sort of its ocular operations of capture. There is a famous French philosopher and anthropologist, Grégoire Chamaillou, and he says a drone has basically a form of a hunting gaze. It follows a kind of hunting, or the violence of the military drone is defined by a manhunt. It is defined, it's not really a declaration of war, it's more sort of the discourse of the hunting. And the idea is that this scopic kind of model of the drone, or the scopic gaze of the drone, sort of highlights a vertical power relation from the hunter to the hunted, from above to bottom. And it's a very hierarchical sort of view to look at the drone's power. And this research on the scopic regime is actually still very pertinent for my approach to drone technology, but I would like to go a bit beyond this idea of the scopic regime, and I would like to highlight what I call the sensorial, that is the experiential and sensorial materiality of the drone. In doing so, I hope to get an insight into its decentralized and dispersed modes of executing power, which is in ways different from the scopic regime of verticality and centrality. But what do I mean with this drone sensorium? How do I define it, and why is it important? The drone sensorium refers to aspects of the sensory, and it implies the question how drones and their agents sense, experience, perceive, and make the world. By foregrounding the sensorial realm of drone technology, I wish to shed light on the material conditions and embodiments made possible by the drone, emphasize its entanglement with cultural imaginaries, as well as the processes of sociality and political practices it is enmeshed with. In this context, the drone and the human subject are not thought as two separate entities, but rather as a type of entwined human-machinic assemblage. Thus, technology is not seen as a, quote, kind of prosthetic of God, as Freud suggested it, but to say it with the words of Walter Benjamin, here is Walter Benjamin again, as something that has subjected the human sensorium to a complex kind of training. In other words, technology, in my approach, also trains the human senses. In the context of drones, the human sensorium, thus, is expanded via the drone technology, and vice versa, the drone attains power, autonomous power, of human-like decision-making by algorithmic image selection in big data streams. This latter aspect, the autonomy of drone operations and the production of operative images, are key to some researchers in media studies. Often these are very much scholars that come from a kind of post-human angle, sort of that the human, in fact, in these machine processes becomes secondary, and the machine sort of has more power to in fact make and generate decisions. And I'm in fact a bit more distanced to that. I think my best background is less technical and more grounded in aesthetic theory. The drone sensorium for me is still bound to an experiencing subject, an agent that interacts with the drone as a viewer and a constructed recipient. So for me, the human is actually still very much in the picture in drone operations. But I mean, I come from the aesthetic aspect, so I focus on the aesthetic representation of drone technology and its experiencing agent. The original Greek word for aesthetics is, in fact, aesthesis, and that refers to sensory perception. This aspect of sensory perception, this aspect of perception from the senses, leads right into the role that aesthetics plays in this lecture. Aesthetics function as a privileged discourse of the drone sensorium, a privileged observer of the drone sensorium. I believe that art and aesthetics is a distinctive field of representation, since it can observe the world in a non-instrumental fashion. And that's actually quite a common thought in aesthetic theory, from Kant to the German Romanticists, to Luhmann, to Rancière. Common, but maybe useful when one sort of wants to highlight the sensorial intensities of drone technology. By means of what Hans-Georg Gadamer called aesthetic differentiation, aesthetics can capture a form of emotional knowledge of the world that goes beyond factual and rational analysis. I'm interested precisely in this emotional knowledge about drone technology, which is derived from the aesthetic realm. And I will focus on contemporary drone art. This is kind of my empirical basis to investigate how aesthetics negotiates, observes, and experiences the sensorial affective qualities of drone technology. In other words, my main thesis in this lecture is that contemporary drone art experiments, recycles, amplifies, exaggerates these sensorial registers of drone technology, and in doing so, these artworks can in fact reflect critically about the execution of power of drone technology. A form of power, which I hope to show, is not really organized in a scopic, hierarchical way, but rather more decentralized and a dispersed and network-like form of power. But perhaps I should talk a little bit more about drone art. I don't know if there are many that are familiar with drone art. There's lots of contemporary art that deals with drones. There is simply also, there are many artists that use drones as a tool. Sort of the drone becomes a brush, or the drone becomes a camera, or the drone becomes something for making a movie. Here you have the brush here. This is a photograph of migrant streams in the Mediterranean shot by a drone. The photographer is Rasmus Deinboll. There's other forms of art. There's, for example, fashion, stealth wear, anti-drone clothing. This is sort of kind of a surveillance art or a counter-surveillance form of art. There is also experimental film, a documentary. This is a type of film that deals with traumatic experiences of a drone pilot. It's kind of an avant-garde documentary film that also plays with the very genre of a documentary film. So it's different than popular films on drones like Eye in the Sky or Homeland and so forth. And then also maybe important to note is James Bridle. He has this idea of drawing drones, Reaper drones, on public spaces, and he also makes a manual so that everybody can sort of follow his idea and paint these drones on public spaces. So there's a lot out there, and actually, I'm as I said, I'm more sort of in the 19th century. I'm actually, my sort of role also in this whole project is also to reconstruct the drone gaze and the aerial view of surveillance back in history, and show also that, in fact, drones are not only a phenomenon of the 21st century, but also that they had, in fact, some predecessors in the early ballooning, and I'm looking at early balloons, ballooning experiences and accounting of balloons that are, in fact, sometimes quite similar to reactions to drone technology. But I will not talk about this today, but rather really focus on one artwork, on one artist that I will introduce a little bit closer. By the way, you are very welcome to interrupt me if you don't understand something, or if it goes too fast or whatever. So, and also in this lecture, I actually would like to focus on the visual sensing. It's called the sensorium of the drone. I have a very long lecture about this, where I also talk about hearing and sound, and also about the kinetic aspects of drone technology. But here I focus on the visual. And the next step is first of all, to show you a little bit how drones see, from military drones, from the technology point of view, and then how art, in fact, engages with that type of visual sensing. In cultural theory and philosophical approaches, military drones are often associated with the quality of hypervisuality. They can see, record, and observe everything. And interestingly, from a zoological point of view, the word drone is also used to classify a male bee of a beehive. I'm sure there is a biologist maybe here, I don't know, so I'm happy to learn also more about that view. But I find that interesting, this relation to the insect, because actually, characteristic for this insect is to have eyes twice the size of a worker bee. Since it mates with the drone queen while in flight, its large eyes are conducive for ensuring reproductions. So the bee's drone sharp eyesight certainly reminds us of the supervision that some military drones are often assumed to have. And in fact, the recent military video capture technology with the mythical name of Gorgon Stare seems to embody this kind of hypervisibility. Scholars of the humanities know Gorgons well. It's a monster species in Greek mythology, and it comprised the three sisters, Medusa, Steno, and Euryale. And in particular, Medusa is famous for turning anyone who looks at her into a stone. Since 2011, a Gorgon works for the American military. So what is that precisely, this Gorgon stare? It's a wide area surveillance technology able to capture motion imagery of a whole city, which data are analyzed by humans and artificial intelligence. This technology incorporates a spherical array of cameras attached to an aerial drone armed with Hellfire missiles. And together with its brother, Argus, again a telling name, that contains over 100 cell phone-like cameras, they can quilt together a mega stream of images into a large-scale mosaic and feed them into networks of the ground stations. In fact, a drone operator is never quite alone. He's always sort of connected to a base where they interpret and select the visual data. Given these almost Olympian powers suggested by Gorgon Stare, a parallel might be drawn to Bentham's Panopticum. The drone gaze seems to be similar to this totalized and synoptic view of the Panopticum. But as I said in my introduction, I actually would like to go beyond this idea of the Panopticum, or also beyond the idea of the scopic. The scopic and the Panopticum are in that sense synonymous. And would rather say that there is actually another form of surveillance going on. The philosopher Sigmund Baumann has pointed out that the drone's visual field of surveillance supersedes the Panopticum, since it neither requires spatial partitions nor fixed architectural boundaries. The multiscopic gaze becomes quite clear when one looks at the spherical distribution of cameras of Gorgon Stare and Argos. These are no longer centralized, but rather multifaceted and constantly changing and constantly on the move. And Baumann also calls drones kind of a form of liquid technology, a technology that surveils no longer according to a perpendicular order, but rather is acentral, flexible, and fluid. And the question is now, how does the aesthetic realm engage with this kind of surveillance, with this kind of liquid and acentral form of surveillance? And in this context, I picked one visual artist. I could have picked many more, but I picked Trevor Palin, who works with this form of visual drone sensing. Trevor Palin is an American, and he is also a geographer, and he and a photographer whose work tackles a lot of data collection and drone sensing. And this is one photograph. It's called the Reaper drone, and one really has to look a long time into this photography before one sees a speck of the drone. There's actually a drone in here, it's a little dirty, so, but it's here, yeah. This is kind of his topic, sort of making sort of the realms of the invisible power. His work is also looking often, is called the hidden spaces, spaces that are not officially on the map, that are sort of black sites, you know, and his photographies are about that. Another fun project is this, that military patches, and it's called Emblems from the Pentagon's Dark World, and these are official and semi-official military patches that American soldiers wear on their uniforms as a signification of honors. And here, it's often also about drone missions. Here you have, when you look closer, also the hunting, the hunter motif again, and the Reaper, and so forth. So these are, in fact, real military patches. They are not artworks. Trevor Palin just collected them. But as I said, in this talk, I am more interested in the aspect of visual sensing. How does a drone in art, how is the visual sensing in art then enacted? And for this matter, I would like to show a short film by Trevor Palin. It's called Drone Vision. And the film is so great because it doesn't have any sound, so I don't have to worry about that. And I actually will speak as this film is playing behind me. It's kind of a strange artwork. It doesn't look like an artwork at all, but it is. You can see it in galleries as well and on his website and so forth. But what I would like you to do is, while I'm talking also about the film, think about, like, what's the idea about this? I mean, how does the drone, the military drone here, see? How is the gaze of the drone, in fact, portrayed? Does it have this kind of super Gorgon vision, or how does it move? Is it maybe lost? Is there some uncertainty, and so forth? Palin's video, this one, exploits a glitch and a security flaw in the way the images were transferred from the drones to the US-based pilot via unencrypted satellite uplinks. The source material for this video was intercepted by an amateur satellite hacker. And at first, the images are... And the film begins with aerial sights from a drone. The margin of the images show all the technical data about location and so forth. And at first, the images are more panoramic into the sky. At times, one sees parts of the aircraft, then the gaze goes downwards onto the ground. The film shows then how the drone circles around one specific point. It zooms into the landscape, mountains, road with tractors, trees, and cars. And then these surveillance pictures do not connect smoothly. Sometimes there are disruptions, it's blurry, it's a scattered image. The drone goes forth and back. Image quality is rather grainy and often foggy by clouds. So in which ways, then, does this video reenact the visual sensing of the drone? Palin's film certainly does not establish a clear scopic regime of the drone, in which the drone and the agents observe the enemies with clear precision. Rather, the art installation performs a type of mimesis towards the visual sensing of the drone. In doing so, it temporarily adopts the same rhythms of the machine. The eye of the viewer merges with the camera eye. Precisely in this moment of adaptation, or mimesis, lies also the critical potential of Palin's film. While the eye of the viewer is being adapted into the ways how the drone machine observes, the viewer experiences static, breaks, and ruptures. In fact, it is almost as if the drone would start to look around for itself. The film not only shows the aerial views from above, but also the drone seems to be looking under the wings of the airplane. It seems to spin around itself. One has the feeling it's not a machine camera, but rather a curious human eye that explores and even winks. The film, Trevor Palin's film, lives itself into the visual sensory modes of the drone by amplifying, exaggerating, and ultimately ironizing them. Thus, in this rather prediscursive and sensorial fashion, art not only critically reflects about the merge between the human and the technical eye of the drone, it also does deconstruct the myth of the hypervisibility, the Gorgon stare, super stare of the drone, since by showing it somewhat, since it shows it also in somewhat disoriented. The drone here in this film is dismantled as visual, unpredictable, and unreliable. And having now shown this kind of visual enactment, these sensorial registers of the military drone technology and its aesthetic embodiment in Palin's work, I would like now to raise the question of the political potential of this artwork and discuss the aspect of community. Does Palin's work incite a critical discourse about the power of the drone technology? Can one see his artwork as a form of political art, or do they complicitly affirm and fetishize drone technology precisely through this act of mimesis? In order to find some answers for these questions, a theorem by Jacques Rancière, a French philosopher, might be guiding. According to Rancière, aesthetics is inherently political because it embodies alternative ways of organizing the world that compete with the ones constructed by politics. Aesthetics is therefore a privileged realm in which to experience and observe the organization of the sensible world. Due to the aesthetics realm of due to its autonomy, its freedom and Zweckfreiheit, modern art represents a medium by which one can experiment with the uttering of different opinions and judgments and tastes. This experience of aesthetic dissensus as Rancière calls it, has in essence a political dimension. The political, however, is not understood in the sense of a political representation, parties, party politics, or law enforcement. Rather, the political is conceived on the level of languages, images, music, and poetry. Via the experience of art, one can practice disagreement, dismantle hierarchies, and exercise freedom. Think of the ambivalence of the drone gaze and the human gaze in Trevor Palin's drone vision. Overstating these sensorial registers are the source for the critical potential of this drone art, since in doing so, the film can alienate, estrange, and dethrone the super technology of the drone. His work no longer unmasks a monolithic authority behind the eye of the drone camera and articulates hierarchies along binary oppositions. Rather, Palin's work eschews a distance of critique by involving the viewer in a type of heightened and intensified sensorial experience of drone technology. Speaking about the sensorial. Yeah. By means of the sensorial experience, I claim that the artwork configures also a sense of community. A community thus can be understood as a dynamic and variable entity constructed by common attitudes, experiences, emotions, and opinions. Palin's film Drone Vision deconstructs the myth of hypervisibility by mocking a disoriented gaze of the drone. The film does not address this gaze exclusively on the level of the individual, but also on this level of the community, on a level of the collective. Remember how the drone camera in Palin's film portrayed landscape and its communities, the villages, the tractors, the forests seen from above. This landscape and its communities is no longer innocent, but rather by means of the machinic gaze and its human operators, it's made into territories of potential risk. The tractor could be steered by a terrorist. The mountains could be hiding spaces for counterinsurgents. The aerial view of the surveilled landscape transmits fear, vulnerability, and threat. Palin's analog clock in the end of the film also emphasizes that the drone gaze has the power to disrupt the time. the landscape gains the temporal dimension to futurity. It shows the traces of a preemptive war that has not even happened yet. Thus, Palin's film demonstrates how drone technology can construct and shape communities of potential enemies by executing a form of biopolitical power based on a hypothetical threat in the future. To come to my conclusion, in this lecture, I wanted to draw your attention to drone art at first, that something like that exists, and its engagement with drone technology. I have tried to show that contemporary drone art no longer exclusively adheres to the rhetoric of the scopic regime, that is, to the hierarchy and binary oppositions and verticality, but rather that the artworks show also the power of the drone in a sensorial type of context, and that its sensorial registers of power are dispersed and swarm-like and diffused. What did this focus on the sensorial do for me, or why is it important? To sum it up, it kind of highlights the decentralized and diffused power of the drone technology, the idea of fluid surveillance. It also reflects about the relationship between machine and subject as an entwined assemblage. That is also what I try to show with Palin's movie or film. And focusing on the sensorial, deconstructs sort of the assumed power of the drone, that it is often seen as the absolute precise weapon, the weapon that doesn't make any mistakes, that is a clinical form of surgery warfare, and it makes us reflect about this construction also of this perfection of this weapon. Yeah, I think that was it. Yeah.